Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to our session against the plantation Osin, Black Ecologists and Environmental Justice, with Imani Jacqueline Brown and Shreya Chatterjee. I'm Daphne Dragona, and I have curated the talks program for this year's IMA Festival. You might have already watched some of our events. The program, taking as a starting point the title of the festival, examines what possession and what being possessed means nowadays in and for the contemporary world. It looks into questions of property, control and exploitation with regard to land and natural resources, identity and human power, information and data. At this afternoon session, we are very happy to have with us Imani and Shreya, who will be talking about extractive plantation ecologies and the urge for resistance and reparations. The format of the session is a little bit different. We have invited Imani to give a presentation and then Shreya to respond to this. After this, they will engage into a conversation. But there is also the possibility to ask questions or make comments by using the YouTube chat function. I would like to briefly say a few words about both of them. So Imani Jacqueline Brown is an artist, activist and writer from New Orleans. Her work investigates the continuum of extractivism from settler colonial genocide and slavery to contemporary gentrification, fossil fuel production, and police and corporate impunity. In exposing the layers of violence and resistance that structure US society, she opens up space to imagine a path to ecological reparations. Among other things, Imani is currently a researcher for forensic architecture. Shreya Chatterjee is an art historian and environmental humanities scholar. Shreya specializes in the political ecologies of art and design in the 19th and 20th centuries, with a particular focus on transnational environmental histories, the histories of art and science, and the relationships between climate and race. She is currently a Swiss National Science Foundation researcher at IXDM and FHNEVE in Basel, an associate scholar at the Max Planck Kunsthistorisches Institut, and a contributing editor at British Art Studies. Shreya also holds a PhD from Princeton University. I would like to warmly welcome both of them and pass the mic over to Imani.
Thank you very much, Daphne. It took the Mississippi River 7,000 years of evulsive leaps to dance the place we now call Louisiana into existence. It took our enlightened society 300 years to destroy it. In 2007, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration removed the names of 31 bodies of water from their maps of Louisiana. The land that formed the perimeters of these ponds, bayous and bays had disintegrated, merging them into open water. Artists and scholars have mourned the loss of these names and places, names and places like Bay Jacquin, Yellow Cotton Bay, Bayou Tony, and Bob Taylor's Pond. But the first name lost was Bulbancha, which means land of many languages in Mobilian, a trade dialect of Choctaw. 300 years ago, French colonists dispossessed dozens of indigenous societies from this ecosystem and imposed the name Louisiana, which means Lewis's land in French. French, Spanish, German, English, and US American settler colonists enslaved people from West Africa and kidnapped them to Louisiana. They displaced them from their lands and dispossessed them of their names. They forced them to terraform the fertile floodplains of the Mississippi into plantations. This practice displaced sediment from into the river, fleshing out the bones where her mouth opens onto the Gulf. Displacement of people prefigures the displacement of names, prefigures the displacement of sediment, prefigures the displacement of names, prefigures the displacement of people. Over the past century, over 100 corporations have dredged 10,000 miles of oil access canals in order to drill 75,000 wells, which connect to over 200 refineries, petrochemical plants, and tank farms through 50,000 miles of pipeline. This invasive infrastructure has brought about the disintegration of the earth, killing the vegetation that holds sediment together as land. 2,000 square miles of Louisiana's coastal wetlands have eroded into the Gulf of Mexico at a rate of one football field every 45 minutes, exposing fragile more than human ecologies to rising seas and strengthening hurricanes powered by climate change. Corporations must be held to account. Restitution must be paid. These truths are undeniable. But redress for the violence of ecological disintegration is more than a financial obligation. We need to repair the segregative rifts driven through existence, driven through our relations with one another. Reparations must be radical, which is to say that they must grow from the root of the crisis. Little by little, or perhaps quickly from the perspective of the earth, enlightened humanity is coming to recognize the need for the dark wisdom it worked hard to extinguish. More and more, Western scholars look with deference and humility toward Anishinaabe original instructions, toward Quechua Sumac Kwase, toward Aboriginal dreaming. Yes, more and more. And yet, so few eco-philosophical voices from Black Africa and her dark diaspora reach the ears of the de-enlightening world. As Maladoma Somé, a spiritual philosopher from the Dagara tribe of Burkina Faso, affirms, the time has come for African philosophy to be recognized beyond the realm of anthropology. It is time for Black studies and critical geography to be reread ecologically, and for the de-enlightening world to sit quietly and listen rapturously to Black people's perspectives on ecological reparations. So what does it mean for Black people to fight for the rights of nature when we are still fighting for our basic human rights? An enlightened cosmology has displaced a worldview of ecological integrity. Humans are segregated from our wider ecological bodies. Black bodies are segregated from the body of humanity. But it is through our bodies that we can learn a thing or two or infinitely more about segregation. Enlightened bodies are as segregated internally as they are externally. The human is segregated from the bacterium, even though 99% of the DNA in the human body is non-human. The enlightened human is segregated from the plants that provide us with the oxygen we need to exist. The plants create this oxygen in turn from the carbon dioxide that the human expels. The human is segregated from the land, which, as Frantz Fanon reminds us, is the most important value because, as he tells us, it provides us with bread and dignity. Beneath the Black body is the body of Earth, which is Black with oil and soil, Black with the cycle of life. Yet classified as Black, Earth becomes extinction's ground zero. As Black human bodies disintegrate under the magnifying lens of enlightenment, the Black body of Earth disintegrates. A sickly rainbow of bodies and souls floats above enlightened ecologies in ethico-eco-philosophical zero gravity. The enlightened human calls this weightlessness freedom. A Black person on a walk through the countryside opens a fissure or a portal in enlightened reality. According to enlightened human reason, to be Black and a lover of nature is unnatural, a contradiction, because being at the bottom of humanity, we exist at the edge of the so-called state of nature. We cannot love nature because we're supposed to hate ourselves. And we cannot share in nature because we must leave nature, we must leave ourselves behind if we are to be welcomed among humanity. Of course, we are nature, just like everything and everyone else. But to admit as much would be a surrender. Or could it be a coup? Human reason is a contradiction. Human reason conflates phenotypical darkness with phenomenological darkness, darkness with the unknown, and the unknown with fear. At war with darkness, enlightened whiteness casts a surgical light. With each shadow banished, new shadows are revealed. Within each particle, smaller particles are found. With each body annihilated or enslaved, assimilated or segregated, the less the enlightened know about themselves. Each person, place, and particle split sounds the bell for the planet splintering. And yet, and still, and therefore, through the alchemical fusion of the phenotypical and the phenomenological, darkness of flesh is imbued with the dark power to reintegrate the world. The workday breaks with the sounding of a bell. It tells the enslaved that it is time for the headcount at the sugar mill. Their arrival is timed. Tardiness is punished by the whip. During harvest season, they work 18 to 20 hour shifts, carrying bundles of cane to the conveyor belt, pushing wood into the belching furnace, carrying away vats of boiling cane syrup. If a pregnant woman tarries in the fields, she must be punished. A hole is dug to protect the unborn asset. If this new life chooses to enter this world during the work shift, a hole is dug to catch it upon arrival. The mother's labor flows seamlessly from birth to plow. They are merely two modes of the same production. The plantation is ruled by the efficiency of enlightened logic. In the 19th century, the 150-mile stretch of land along the Mississippi River between New Orleans and the state capital of Baton Rouge was hemmed by a corset of hundreds of sugarcane plantations. After the Civil War, Freetown communities of emancipated Black people grew out of rows of slave cabins. Today, they are fence-line communities, neighboring some of the nation's most polluting industrial facilities, which occupy the fallow footprints of those plantations. Each year, many millions of tons of carcinogens, chemical gases, spew from these facilities, impairing reproductive organs, irritating the skin, and debilitating the respiratory system. Louisiana ranks among the US states with the most lax air emissions regulations and the highest rates of cancer. In 2014, the Governing Council of the Parish of St. James, Louisiana, passed a comprehensive land use plan. It redesignated the parish's Black Freetown communities as, quote, existing residential / future industrial. The plan began by reminiscing about the bygone era of, quote, luxurious living, sumptuous entertainment, and delightful ease, when acres of land were counted by thousands and slaves by hundreds, end quote. In the 19th century, sugarcane was known as the most dangerous crop to cultivate. Louisiana's sugar districts bore a negative birth rate among the enslaved population. Since the war, outputs of tons of sugar have been replaced by tons of aviation fuel, fertilizer, and plastic nurdles. Byproducts remain the same: structural racism, depleted ecologies, foreclosed futures. Environmental racism is a continuum that spans for 300 years, from colonialism and slavery to cancer, coastal erosion, and climate change. This region was once called plantation country, but today they call it the petrochemical corridor. Black residents know their homeland as Death Alley. The habituating force, the raison d'etre, and the end product of the plantation ecology is death. Plantation ecologies are invasive. Once industrial monocrop agriculture has drained life from soil, the oil industry spreads throughout the Black Earth's fractal viscera. Her skin crawls with prisons and petrochemical plants. Plantation ecologies are virulent. As capitalism advances and thickens like a strangling vine, all the world produces strange fruit. In 2018, a group of residents in St. James rose up in resistance, forming Rise St. James. In December of 2019, they announced that several cemeteries likely holding the remains of their enslaved ancestors, had been located on the construction site of the Sunshine Project, a new 3.5 square mile plastics production complex comprised of 14 separate facilities owned by Taiwanese company Formosa Plastics. Last year, RISE organized a prayer service at one of the cemeteries to commemorate Juneteenth, the anniversary of the emancipation of enslaved people across the US South. Formosa filed a restraining order to block the community from visiting their ancestors' resting place. But the presiding judge overruled Formosa's objection, stating that Black communities needed healing amid the uprising of last year. These cemeteries became the front line of resistance to the continuum of enlightened extractivism. But in order to heal, historic preservation must do so much more. It must work not only to protect the memory of the past, but it must work to repair our future. As Sharon Levine, founder of RISE, says, we need clean air, water, and soil. We need our trees to bear fruit once again. There are hundreds of such cemeteries across Louisiana's petrochemical plantations. Each plantation had at least one, sometimes as many as three. And RISE St. James has urgently commissioned forensic architecture to help locate them. These unmarked burial grounds are regularly desecrated and disarticulated by pipelines, waste retention ponds, and borrow pits. The bodies of our ancestors are scooped up along with the earth used to maintain the levees that restrained the river. While many cemeteries have already been destroyed, sometimes they remain as islands of trees afloat in seas of cane. After death, enslaved Black people were no longer profitable. Black bodies were buried in uncultivated tracts of land at the back of the plantation, at the edge of the bottomland hardwood cypress forests. The wetland forest was feared by the enlightened planter class. It was a place of thousand-year-old cypress trees, harboring alligators and villages of maroons, a word for self-emancipated Black people. These invaluable lands, these non-places, are for us the zones of liminal freedom. The enslaved were denied headstones, so they planted wild magnolias to mark the graves of loved ones, carrying a Pan-African tradition into this brave new world. The trees here today are descendants of these magnolias. They hold bodies of land and people together against the tides of disintegration and desecration. These Black ecologies root our memories to a future of ecological integration. What would it mean to continue the work of our ancestors? Black ecologies travel with the Black body on tides of cellular memory and seed in the gap between worlds. They know our struggling, our suffering, and our survival. They are our struggle, our suffering, and our survival. They are our hope, our joy, and our grief, mingled and messy. Black ecologies grow from the human bodies that block pipelines and petrochemical plants. They are cultivated by human hands that plant marsh grasses in humble rituals of repair. They blossom as memories of plantation plots in community gardens and in the secret jars political prisoner Herman Wallace kept in his solitary confinement cell. They flourish as the great green walls initiated in African sacred groves. Black ecologies are syncretic. They generate systems for mutual living, living systems, by synergizing poetry and science, past and future, teachings from north, south, east, and west, networking the many into the one. Black ecologies are diasporic. They spread to the rhythm of grandma's knitting needles, weaving the world's loving reintegration. Whatever their scale, they are expansive because they photosynthesize the wisdom of more than human ancestors. Black ecologies cannot decompose Timothy Morton's plastic dark ecology, a philosophy of coexistence that holds no space for the repair of racism. Nor are Black ecologies fooled by the Cartesian logics that tell us that Black is the lowest point on the spectrum to white. Black ecologies laugh with deadly gravity at the confusion of enlightened human reason. Black is not the absence of light. Black absorbs light, holding it close to its bosom. Black ecologies are the nadir to Enlightenment's zenith. Enlightenment has lifted us to unthinkable heights of madness. Black ecologies orient us intuitively toward Earth. Black ecologies don't upend the hierarchy that places Black people at the bottom of humanity and humanity above Earth, shifting Black to the top and white to the bottom, but rather explodes it outward from the base. Humanity will horizontalize, lying prostrate as human, ashamed neither of our big toes nor our whole bodies pressing into the ground in a sublime encounter with our Earth, with our kin, with ourselves. Black ecologies multiply. They are migratory. They resist extinction. Don't be frightened. Black ecologies won't replace you. They will repair you. They will restore us. Black ecologies will hold us all. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Imani, for your incredibly powerful and so moving talk. Of the many things that really strikes me about your work, one is the insistence on the relationship of our current crises with longer intersectional histories. The ecological crisis is clearly an intersectional one. The etymological roots of ecology makes us aware of the primacy of relationality, in this case of organisms to one another and to their physical surroundings. The ecological crisis too is an irrefutably relational constitution in which overlapping systems of oppression need to be considered in constant dialogue with the past, present, and future, as you have shown us. Rather than responding to your talk directly, although I hope we will have time and the opportunity to do this in the question and answer session, I wanted to keep thinking with you on the broader themes of your work. To do this, I will highlight the work of scholars whose work continue to be integral to my learning, namely Mithri Jegathesan, Catherine McCritick, Zoe Todd, Shadrach Chirikure, Macarena Gomez-Barris, and Max Liboiron. Expanding on the theme for today's session, against the plantationist scene, I wanted to root around the term for a moment. The Anthropocene, as we all know, and we've heard kind of enough about it already, is a geological term with deeply political implications. And the Anthropocene pointed to the advent of a carbonized economy following the invention of the steam engine and expansive capitalism as the decisive moment when human action first became a planetary force of geological scale. The marking of the Anthropocene has been roundly critiqued for itself being a product of colonial geology, in which spikes are named after universalizing anthropos, while actually the Anthropocene is best viewed as a racial process that has produced and continues to produce racially uneven vulnerability and death. So in 2015, Donna Haraway introduced the term plantationocene as a framing alternative to the Anthropocene. The plantationocene outlines the transportation of genomes, the transportation of breeding plants and animals, including people, how this is crucial to the plantation, and involves the alienation of multiple species and their abstractions and replaceabilities within a scaled up networking of those species for profit. It focuses on plantation as a broad system of extraction. As Mithri Jegathesan has shown, the plantation scene raised concerns around its production of knowledge regarding intersections of race, gender, history, and location. So in 2019, Janae Davis, Alex Moulton, Levi Van Sant, and Brian Williams published Anthropocene, Capitalocene, Plantationocene, a manifesto for ecological justice in an age of global crises. They argued that the Plantationocene concept had two limitations. A cursory treatment of racial sexual oppression related to plantation economies, and a flattened notion of making kin that is inadequate for the creation of more just ecologies in the plantation present. As Jegathesan writes, non-Black feminist collectives of and in the Global South raise similar critiques. The Plantationocene overlooks long-standing Black, Indigenous, and Latinx dispossession and colonial forces. 2 years before the coining of the term Plantationocene, in 2013, Catherine McCritick published an article titled Plantation Futures in the Caribbean Studies journal Small Axe. McCritick asks, what is at stake in linking a plantation past to the present? What comes of positioning the plantation as a threshold to thinking through longstanding contemporary practices of racial violence? I find McCritick's questions underlining Imani's work as she says, to return oxygen to humanity, each bounded Black body must be named. Each name must be known. So settler colonialism, as we saw in Imani's talk, is an unfinished and continuously evolving project. And the intimate interrelationships between transatlantic slavery, land grabs, genocide, ecocide, fossil fuel economies, and the financialization of nature continue to shape the global present. What coincided with the invention of the steam engine and expansive capitalism was the establishment of the modern order of the natural sciences and the division made by European intelligentsia between themselves, being bearers of culture, and the exotic other, occupants of what was taken to be a pre-modern natural world. It was the beginning of the making of alterity, the creation of the other. The representation of nature as other is also a Euro-American construct. Even though we think we're way past these binaries, these fundamental epistemic biases leak into the way a Eurocentric academy continues to produce scholarship. Take posthumanism, for example, where scholars in the Euro-American context work towards a non-anthropocentric worldview. In continuously referring to a foundational ontological split between nature and culture as if it is universal, posthumanist theories erase indigenous epistemologies. In getting to know Imani's work, there are two things that emerge to me as really important: erasure and accountability. Teacher Dimas has argued that the Anthropocene rhetoric through images and texts often acts as a mechanism of universalization, which obscures the accountability of the military state corporation apparatus. It allows instead for a kind of eco-catastrophical aesthetic, which does not speak to the longer systemic capitalist processes and the complex entanglements of corporations, governments, and institutions. As artists and art historians, what becomes crucial to our methods is then the question not only of how we see, but how we make visible, what we make visible, and why we make something visible. The forensic nature of artistic research in Imani's work is, of course, vital. It offers tools of resistance, making visible patterns of structural violence and difficult historical trajectories in multi-species contexts that would otherwise go unnoticed. The archaeologist Shadrach Chirikure writes about how most famous European explorers actually followed the leads left by African miners and used local informants to identify mineral-rich regions. Indigenous methods of mining and metalworking were sustainable, ecologically friendly, and produced output with minimal impacts to the environment. Such mining techniques supplied a major component of the gold that circulated in the Indian Ocean system until the 1700s. Other than gold, indigenous techniques of mining and metallurgy also produced iron, which the missionary David Livingstone found in the late 19th century to be of better quality than that was produced in Europe at the time. Indigenous technologies were banned and assaulted by missionaries and colonial administrators, while indigenous cosmologies were attacked for being demonic and barbaric. Capitalism created relationships of dependence whereby Africans had to sell their labor for a living while helplessly watching the destruction of their environment. The big question, according to Chirikure, is can we introduce indigenous values and approaches to the environment to arrest the disaster capitalism-induced ecological crisis? Or is indigenous knowledge nostalgia that cannot work under the changed circumstances of the present? Equally important in this context is the question of who has been erased and who can be held accountable. In my own work on South Asia, I find it crucial to excavate not just longstanding histories of colonial domination, but also the gradations of power and privilege, the place of landed elites who carefully defended racial privilege, political power, and extractivist capitalism. What other kind is there? As with land, so too with water. Macarena Gomez Barris, in writing about the British artist John Okomfra's Vertigo Sea, calls it a complex liquid geography, where the ocean is the container, a void, the space of abolition, the site of massacre, and where the history of the non-human is presented alongside the history of racialized humanity's devaluation. Okomfra uses the BBC footage from the six-part series Planet Ocean with historical footage of capture, whether it be of whale hunts or the recreation of the washing up of black bodies on beaches from the transatlantic slave trade. As Gomez Barris says, Vertigo Sea is not about producing histories of equivalence, but instead making evident how the archival presence of the sea acts as a visual mediator for colonial and anthropogenic brutality. As Zoe Todd has so powerfully argued, water can be polluted in other ways. Polluted with memories of colonial events, littered with shipwrecks and other materials that we have yet to know the long-term social or spiritual or physical impacts or implications of. In the same way as what we know is political, what we don't know is equally political. Erasure and accountability are both happening and possible on multiple scales. Max Liboron writes that pollution is not a manifestation or side effect of colonialism, but is rather an enactment of ongoing colonial relations to land. These colonial relations are reproduced through even well-intentioned environmental science and activism. I'm going to close with Max Liboron's words. Whether motivated by profit and growth or environmental conservation, both approaches to waste and wasting are premised on an assumed entitlement to indigenous land. That's colonialism.
Hi, Shreya. Thank you so much for your response. It's really wonderful to be in conversation with you. I'm really interested in, you know, this notion of sustainable mining and metallurgy that you brought up. It was something that, you know, I guess I never really thought about, because certainly there, you know, were metals in circulation prior to extractive methods. And as like a really specific example of like, you know, an indigenous technology that, as you said, was banned and replaced with something that has sort of propelled us on this in this unidirection toward collapse, right? And this question of you know, like how these practices can be, you know, not just honored and respected, but, you know, can they actually come back into play and into practice? And I think this is just like something that, you know, we think about a lot, and, you know, also in relation to mineral resources, to oil and gas, you know, and recognizing that, you know, of course, we have a world that's extremely globalized for better and for worse, and that we're often until now kind of caught up in this kind of constant movement around the world. I myself live quite far away from my home, from Louisiana, where my family is, and so, you know, how are we able to actually retain these connections with these like local nodes around the world without, you know, extractive technologies? And of course, we also have to recognize that that the human population has always been migratory and that people have always managed to move around the world. And, you know, there are so many questions we need to ask ourselves about how do we expand our imagination in such a way? Is it, you know, is it just toward like finding new power sources using lithium, you know, which is itself the product of another extractive, you know, economy, yeah. right? Like to propel yeah. us around the world or what else is there?
Yeah, exactly. And I think the other thing that I'm always struggling with when it comes to thinking about how to reanimate and respect Indigenous knowledges is also the danger of co-option. Because I think Chadrek Chirikure also writes about, you know, what sustainable capitalism is. It's a paradox. There can be no sustainable capitalism. So I think just the danger of some practices being taken up in a process of greenwashing is very real. And I think it's also the work of scholars such as yourself and others to kind of point out the many layers of the many ways in which ideas can get co-opted into an existing system. And so whether that then means, or how we can work with that system, or can we work with that system, or do we need to move away out of that system and dismantle it?
Absolutely the latter, right?
So I think these are quite interesting sort of things to think about. And it leads me back to so many fantastic sort of points in your talk, which shows how everything is so connected to each other. I wondered also if you might talk a little bit more specifically about your Unraveling Infrastructure project, because what really strikes me is the fact that you're doing historical research as well as kind of forensic research at the moment. And I'm curious as to what your methods are, or how you kind of, maybe not what your methods are, but how you build your methods in a sense, and how they grow and how they change and that sort of thing.
It's a really nice way to frame it. Because I certainly think that my practice is something that is like it grows along with me, like you know, I've been an activist, you know, for a long time, for most of my life. I'm from Louisiana, and was in New Orleans when Katrina hit in 2005. And so I've like recently started to think about my practice as a way of trying to really like unearth the layers of, you know, structural violence and oppression that made my and my family's displacement by Katrina possible. And I think this, you know, kind of like early experience of displacement, and of course, like the complete, you know, dispersal of my, like, you know, like immediate as well as like wider kind of like local community, right? Katrina saw 100,000 Black residents kind of displaced, never to return. And we call it actually Katrina's diaspora. Has you know, kind of like led me to, I think it's like given me a peculiar kind of like relationship with locality and with my place. And I also feel like a deep connection, even as I feel increasingly that I can't live there. But I feel like I must stay connected to it and do work. That a diaspora doesn't mean that there aren't still like threads, connective tissues between the various nodes, right? So I returned to New Orleans after having been living on the East Coast since the hurricane back in 2013. And when I did, I started to notice all of these fossil fuel logos slowly saturating the civic institutions throughout the city. Louisiana is the second poorest state in the US, and it's extremely disinvested It's second only to Mississippi, goddamn. And so our schools and our cultural institutions, our science centers, our climate change centers are covered in these fossil fuel logos. I organized a festival called Fossil Free Fest that was imagined first as like sort of a space to celebrate the end of the fossil fuel era, which, you know, was already upon us. I said optimistically, and along with other local artists and activists, including Monique Verdun, we wanted to organize a space that kind of tapped into New Orleans's kind of traditional modes of like of doing political work, which is cultural, right? And is we always combine, you know, celebration and grief. So even as, you know, the transition out of the fossil fuel era is going to be a combination of those two things. And it was a space for us to start to like understand our complicity in this system, our entanglement within it. Ask ourselves what happens when we allow our institutions, you know, to not just be funded by the industry, because I do believe that the industry owes us a great deal of money, to say the very least, but specifically to place their logos as sort of an endorsement of their activities on our beloved institutions. And the industry has a term called the social license to operate, which basically says that in today's society, a company cannot operate sustainably. It's the word that the then VP of BP, of British Petroleum, used, but they cannot operate sustainably without the support of society, hence philanthropy. And, you know, in conversations with my colleagues, I was at the time the director of programs at Antenna, a local arts organization, and in my conversations with various colleagues throughout the like local like art and cultural and other sectors, I heard a lot of, you know, folk talking about or kind of arguments that, well, like the oil company that gives me money, that gives my institution money, is not one of the ones that's most responsible for ecological degradation. And I knew that was not true, and that there was evidence to the contrary. There, the state of Louisiana has a huge database of information on mineral resources, permits for oil and gas wells and canals and pipelines, which are publicly available. They exist online, but they're not accessible. It's really just the clunkiest website. I mean, exactly as you would imagine, like a state oil and gas like management website is not very functional. So I came to the Center for Research Architecture at Goldsmiths as a way of developing kind of like my practice further. My practice was always an activist practice, a cultural activist practice, very much engaged with people in real place and time. And I really wanted to develop a practice of being able to like actually map accountability. And that's where, you know, the images that you've seen are kind of the more like artsy, I guess, like kind of experiments that I'm making. I'm actually building at the moment a very functional platform as well that will enable the public for the first time actually to view and organize oil and gas infrastructure by company. And I wanted to use the logo specifically to map wells, so that, you know, we're reorienting attention like away from, you know, like the good work that they're doing, you know, like by funding our institutions, and actually put it where the real work is happening, right? The work of disintegrating, you know, like our place and our future.
I'm also curious, just to kind of follow up on what you were saying about the same institutions who are, you know, who have the fossil fuel logos on them. What do you think you would be able to engage once you have this, once your mapping platform is complete? Do you expect to be able to engage with these institutions as well and have them, you know, do things and find ways to subvert their relationships?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, and I think, you know, I want to be very just like, I want to be very careful about, you know, like lambasting them too much, because of course they're in an extreme financial, like a state of financial precarity, right? It's very difficult Gosh, I can't even imagine what it is like now in the COVID era, but it was always difficult to just keep the lights on, right? But then of course there's a question of like, well, what does it matter to keep our lights on if the building is underwater? We were actually organizing a second iteration of Fossil Free Fest that was supposed to launch in April of last year, so it didn't. And the event was really organized on transition, right? And one of the ideas is around like kind of like a fossil free pack, as we were calling it, but basically like, you know, imagining different ways of like fundraising and different support systems, like ways that like, you know, we could build a kind of fundraising, you know, kind of practice that is not competitive, where like every institution is like pitted against the other, but actually where, you know, institutions sort of bundle together, right, and fundraise collectively and distribute the money, right? And the idea was that like by specifically like if these institutions like refuse fossil fuel funding, right, that, you know, this fossil free pack, like, you know, would attract far more kind of attention than any individual institution would on its own, right? And so like just, yeah, like trying to imagine possibilities so that we're not just critiquing, right, like the institutions that take this funding and do so honestly, like unthinkingly. It's not like anyone is like thinking like, ooh, I'm gonna take this money and put this logo on my institution so that like the fossil fuel industry will like have a good look, right? But really just like helping us like let's talk it through, like let's talk through what it is we're doing and how we can transform.
Yeah, I think what you were talking in your kind of presentation, this idea of resistance and repair being in some ways in constant dialogue, I think was really interesting for me, kind of both theoretically, but also to see, as you describe, your unraveling infrastructure platform and also other kinds of work, to see how that plays out in real life as well. So what maybe to frame it as a question, how do you see resistance and repair constantly in conversation in your work?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just this, the Black Ecologies text, it came not just at a moment, but, you know, like at a time when I was really, I mean, certainly as I have been doing this mapping work for some time and following up on Fossil Free Fest, but, you know, I've been an activist for a very long time. I was involved in Occupy Wall Street when I was living in New York, and the relief effort actually that followed up, which I've forgotten about, was just speaking with a friend about yesterday, that followed up the Hurricane Sandy that hit New York in 2012. And, I think that, you know, like it, there's one can't simply like critique the system that we have. One has to be kind of, and critique is a form of repair in a sense, right? You have to, you know, actually understand the way that the, you know, like if something is broken, you have to understand the way that the pieces fit together, right? Where the rifts are before you can place it back together. But there's also just something for like, you know, the sake of your own like soul and like mental health that, you know, you can't just constantly talk about the violence, right? You have to, move beyond that. And it's interesting because like I thought like in Occupy Wall Street, like, you know, one of the things that I like, people like often will critique it of like, well, what did Occupy do? And it's like Occupy was a space where like a lot of conversations happened and some marches and, you know, a form of protest. But like, I think that the relief effort was like the real movement, like that's actually where all of the kind of like ideas around like mutual aid, came into practice. And basically this hurricane had hit New York, and as soon as, you know, the lights were back on in Lower Manhattan, everyone forgot about it. But actually all of these disadvantaged, you know, disinvested communities, majority, you know, like people of color communities, large, like migrant worker populations, undocumented workers, just, you know, were completely forgotten about. And so the, like, you know, hurricane relief effort was a way of, you know, not just like, you know, providing kind of like material support and like gutting support and whatnot of houses, but also of like, helping, kind of like doing that work so that like, residents would be freed up and would have the time to start to regroup and to organize, right? So not to say that we needed to be doing that organizing for them, but that they just needed the time when they weren't trying to find food and water to be able to do that.
Yeah, that seems so crucial. Thanks, Imani. Daphne is here, and I was just wondering if she has.
Yeah, we have a question from Maya. I think it's for both of you, so I will read it. So the question is, thank you for your thoughtful contributions. Could you both say a bit about how you see accountability in different scales and locations being separate and where they come together?
I think that's a really wonderful question. I tend to be very kind of, at the moment, I tend to be very sort of like focused on Louisiana because it's the place that I know the best. And it's the place that like I feel both accountable to and responsible for. And I try not to sort of step out of my lane in a way. I think it's really difficult, right? Because I think that I've been looking into some different types of like legal mechanisms. There's one that's called unjust enrichment. And it's like this kind of like funny doctrine. It's a form of equitable remedy. And it says it exists in state as well as like federal and international law. And it says that if a party has profited from activities that have impoverished another party, those activities are unjust and must be restituted to the impoverished party. So I think there's like a very clear case for how the full continuum of extractivism from slavery and colonialism to the fossil fuel industry has impoverished Louisiana economically, materially, ecologically, in terms of public health. I've done some calculations for like the actual dollar value of oil that's been extracted from wells in Louisiana. And that would be the money that needs to be restituted. But then the question is like restituted to where and to whom and what form does that restitution take and how do you define the limits? Because it's really important to remember that, while Louisiana is also the victim of the industry, we are historically, one of the top five producers of oil and gas in the U.S. And therefore, we're also one of the most responsible parties in the world for climate change, right? And so what is our responsibility, not just to Louisiana, but to the rest of the world, to the global south, right? To people and communities with whom, we should be in solidarity, right? As, settler colonial or post-colonial societies, right? I don't have an answer, but these are the things that I think are really important to work through.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I also really, really agree with this idea of accountability at multiple scales. All of us are also, all of us also need to be held accountable for our kind of very small actions and then how we can think about accountability in like larger and larger scales. And one of the things that I think for me has been really important is to think about historical accountability versus also holding or thinking about how accountability functions right now in the sort of corporation government nexus. And whether the work of sort of historians and scholars at the moment is also to make visible what kinds of accountability can be held, right? And I think the first step to holding something accountable, somebody or some body accountable, is understanding what the problems are. So I think this idea of like talking things through, kind of finding spaces in which to kind of understand a granular research-based idea is really important, I think, for me, just in terms of practice as well. Thank you for the question. Daphne, I was wondering if, hi.
Hello.
I was wondering if you had any other questions or if...
No, I think we are close to our closing. I don't know if you have some final thoughts that you would like to share before we close this session.
I don't know about Imani. I think I just really wanted to say thank you to Daphne for inviting me to respond to Imani. And I'm just very much looking forward to following and seeing more of your work, Imani.
Great to stay in touch. Yeah, thank you, Daphne, as well. And thank you, Shreya. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you both very, very much for this beautiful, but also powerful, moving, but also political statements and presentations and the overall discussion. We were very happy and honored to have you with us here this afternoon. And yeah, for the audience that is watching, thank you for watching. We will be back here at 7 o'clock with the last event, which is a performance, lecture performance by Liam Young. Thank you very much, Imani and Shreya, and have a good afternoon or evening.
Thank
ciao,
you.
Ciao.
Enjoy the sun. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Hello. Welcome everybody to our next presentation. And my name is Alfred Rothort from the EMAF Festival. I will introduce this presentation after Daphne Dragona, our curator for the talks program of the EMAF 2021, has introduced the previous talks. Thank you, Daphne, for your wonderful introductions and for the excellent cooperation already. While planning the talks with Daphne, the idea appeared to include performative formats in the talks as well. And we decided to present a special work at the end of the 3 days talks program. It will be the film Planet City and the Return of Global Wilderness by Liam Young. In the storytelling performance, we go on a science fiction safari through an imaginary city of the entire population of the Earth, where 10 billion people surrender the rest of the world to a global scaled wilderness and the return of stolen lands. About Liam Young. He is a speculative architect and director who operates in the spaces between design, fiction and futures. He is co-founder of Tomorrow's Thoughts Today, an urban future think tank exploring the local and global implications of new technologies and unknown fields. A nomadic research studio that travels on expeditions to chronicle these emerging conditions as they occur on the ground. Described by the BBC as the man designing our futures, his visionary films and speculative worlds are both extraordinary images of tomorrow and urgent examinations of the environmental questions facing us today. Unfortunately, Liam Young can't be with us today on Zoom, but we have his artistic contribution to the festival, which you will see now. Please enjoy.
All cities are fictions. Their literal edges are nebulous, and their physical definition is endlessly being rewritten. But in many ways, their boundaries come into focus as shared narratives. The fiction of a city can weigh as much as its physical shadow. They are lived and occupied, read and watched with consequence and meaning. I am a director and architect, and I tell stories about cities, some real and some imagined. The urban imaginary has always been a site in which to prototype new scenarios and emerging cultures. In their speculative streets, we play out multiple, unexpected, unintended futures in their associated social and political ideologies. Whether it be speculation around the impacts of industrialization and mass production, the imminent arrival of driverless cars, seamless augmented reality, or artificial intelligence, these fictional worlds give form to our most wondrous technological possibilities and gravest concerns. The Ecumenopolis, or planet-wide city, has long been a narrative of science fiction. The term was coined in 1967 to describe the narrative concept of total planetary urbanization. Across the history of imaginary cities, amongst others, the worldwide city has taken on the form of the sprawl in William Gibson's trilogy, a world without trees and silent running, and Trantor, a planet entirely of architecture in Asimov's Foundation trilogy. Today, the Ecumenopolis is no longer a fiction, however. We are all already citizens of a planetary city. Following centuries of colonization, globalization, and never-ending economic extraction, we have remade the world from the scale of the cell to the tectonic plate. Urban development has forever changed the composition of the atmosphere, the oceans, and the earth. There is no city and country anymore, no nature or technology. Instead, we have engineered a continuous urban construct that stretches across the entirety of the earth. It is an unevenly distributed megastructure that hides in plain sight. It wasn't master planned by a single imperial power or a cyberpunk megacorporation. It was slowly stitched together from stolen lands by planetary logistics, where landscapes have become resource fields, countries have become factory floors, the countryside has become industrialized agriculture, and the oceans have become conveyor belts. The dystopias of science fiction that previously read as speculative cautionary tales are now the stage sets for the everyday, as we live out our lives in a disaster film that's playing in real time. Any aspirational or distant future has given way to the critical re-narration of the dystopian present. The future is broken, and we are left stranded in the long now, staring at empty calendars, doom-strolling idly, waiting for the end of the world. In this moment without a future, as a slow-motion catastrophe envelops us at a speed that makes it uncomfortable to ignore, I want to tell a story about another planet city. A counter-narrative. A story about a concentrated city for the entire population of the Earth. The anti-city to the sprawl we all inhabit. This talk is a story of these two cities. Two cities the size of the planet. A city symphony, a portrait of places stitched together from fragments of science fiction films that I've made with my production company here in LA, and scenes from a series of narrative documentaries we have shot around the world with the documentary studio Unknown Fields that I run from London with Kate Davies. Slipping between fiction and documentary, it will be a sci-fi safari between these two cities. One that is already here, and another that will never exist. As we begin, we are standing in Planet City, a single city for 10 billion people, the projected global population of 2050. We can hear the hums and crackles of flickering blue and red LEDs that illuminate the lower reaches of the city's farm fields. It smells of soil and hard drives and sweet fruit. A purple sunrise over a new kind of wild. Seminal biologist Ebido Wilson imagined a new world he called Half Earth. It was a plan to stave off mass extinction by devoting half the surface of the Earth completely to nature. For Wilson, the magnitude of the problems that face us are far too large to be tackled with small gestures, and any solution must respond to this scale and urgency. The byproduct of Wilson's global park is the massive consolidation of our existing cities and lifestyles that would be required to withdraw to the remaining 50% of Earth. Would we be willing to make such an extraordinary change? What would our lives in this new world order look like? This speculation is where Planet City begins. What if we were to redesign and visualize this radical reversal of our planetary sprawl? Such extraordinary crises require the most radical and bold responses. How far could we push Wilson's proposal to save the Earth? In its most provocative form, if we were to reorganize our world at the intensity of the densest cities that currently exist, then Planet City could occupy as little as 0.02% Earth. Could we imagine a global consensus to retreat from our vast network of cities and entangled supply chains into this one hyper-dense metropolis? Our planetary city is an extraordinary constellation of products, goods, and technologies. From the smallest and most inconsequential of objects to the most intricate and complex, these material things set in motion a vast, planetary-scale infrastructure. In a world of bytes and bitcoins, cyberspace and clouds, 90% of the world's cargo still travels by sea. It's not beamed or teleported or conjured into existence along strings of fiber optics, but rather it's dragged across the planet in heaving steel megaships. Gizzards filled with glistening gadgets and gizmos. Refined geologies wrenched from the earth and scattered to the sea. The global shipping fleet connects the massive mining excavations distributed on the edge of the world, the sites where our planetary city begins and ends its life. In our imaginary planet city, we imagine the world shipping fleet that has been used to scatter matter ripped from the earth across the storefronts of our global streets has been reversed, to bring that material back together again as seams of planetary culture and architecture performed through the geological strata of the city. To build our new city, we mined the old ones rather than virgin ground. Piece by piece, we will dismantle the world we once knew and recast it in new configurations. One by one, we arrived in a global citizen consensus. A voluntary and multi-generational retreat from the world we once knew. A deafening roar sometimes begins with just the softest whisper. In the distance, out on the uneven edges of our planetary city is the lithium triangle, the electric earth that will soon power our world. If we had to stage such a retreat, it would mean reimagining landscapes like this one. This tessellated ocean of evaporation ponds cuts through a region of Chile, Bolivia, and Argentina, and contains almost all of the world's lithium resources, the key ingredient in all of our batteries. Our collective dreams of a renewable planet The prophecies and profiteering of tech evangelist Elon Musk are all buried here beneath the salt flats of Bolivia. The indigenous population that belongs to this land tell a creation story of lithium. They talk of the tears and breast milk of a mythic volcano that is mixed together to crystallize into this lithium lake. The massive mining landscape carved out of one of the rarest and most precious ecosystems on the planet is the geology enacted when you power your laptop or slide your slimline phone into your pocket. Although it sits well beyond the horizon of towering buildings and dense streets of the cities that most of us currently inhabit, it is a product of the city, and in turn produces the city. It is a landscape hidden in the stretching shadows, disguised, ignored, forgotten, invisible in the ad for the latest Apple I everything, or the hype of the Hyperloop. We power our city with the breast milk of volcanoes. In our imaginary planet city, the bright white of the lithium salt flats fades into pink, the beta carotene of the city's algae canals. These are the batteries of planet city, alive with fish and algae. As excess wind and solar power pumps water through canals to high-altitude holding lakes in the city's upper floors. Lithium batteries are replaced by the potential energy of elevated water bodies, snaking amongst the towers. Before dawn, thousands of autonomous cleaning blades squeak along the solar fields. Waves of mirrors ripple as they rotate to chase the changing light. 1 billion panels, collected from all over the world, charges the city canals. When needed, the dams open and the turbines turn. Tides rise and fall as lights glow, televisions blare, and hard drives spin. The lights of the city farms flicker on. We are not precious about where we get our light. A synthetic sun casts purple shadows, yet still warms the skin and helps fertilize the soil. The blue and red spectrum of light is the most efficient for growth. The stacked farms funnel in the city's carbon. It is a sequestration and scrubbing unit, the byproduct of which is food for the city. Beyond the planet city walls, in the other city, deep in the snowy Siberian Ural Mountains, the cucumbers of the double-glazed indoor farms know no seasonal boundaries. 600-watt sodium bulbs run across the ceiling in measured rows of artificial suns. The simulated sky turns off at 8 a.m. and back on at 2 p.m. as an automated, accelerated day is programmed to induce faster growth. A group of neighbors overlooking the farm save on their electricity bills by leaving their lights off in the evening and opening their curtains to the cucumbers illuminated below. Our existing planetary city turns day to night and night to day, populating our stores with goods across a singular, endless planetary season. We chase the seasons through the height of the city. Vertical orchards weave through the tower's 160 floors. Between them, birds migrate across climate zones, while shepherds herd the harvest bots and nomadic neighborhoods follow the pattern of the fruit blooms. young Indian textile worker walks the planetary city cotton fields. The water of the city pours in. These landscapes produce the $3 t-shirt, an icon of the existing modern city. Fast fashion's rolling tide dumps mountains of cheap clothing onto our shores. Objects of desire, worn for one wild night and destined to be discarded. If we were to pick at a loose thread and unravel it to cross the planetary city, we would be traveling from wardrobe to warehouse, from factory to field, in search of the landscapes behind our runway dreams and street blue jeans. Before we wear them, our clothes make journeys of tens of thousands of miles in their process of production, making textiles the most globalized industry in the planetary city. The byproduct of this pace and scale of production is the destruction of the very thing that brought this industry to Southeast Asia originally. In the existing planetary city, we meet the last generation of master weavers, a group whose skills now die with them. The apprentices they would once train now man the rumbling, mechanized looms of global fashion, raw cotton plugging their ears, deaf to the din of the world around them. And we visit the last real gold thread maker, an alchemist lovingly tweaking the machine his grandfather made, resisting the move to synthetic, cheap and fake yarns used by all the other companies around him. Slowly, she walks through the row of plants on a sacred procession from her home village amongst the cotton fields to the huge mills and factories of the vast textile industry supply chain where she works. As she walks across the city, she is gradually wrapped in the glistening gold textile, bearing witness to a series of transformations like weaving, dyeing, sewing, and pressing. Her journey suggests the walk along the fashion catwalk, but also the walk our disposable fashion takes in its process of global production, and the path so many women like her have taken in moving from village to factory to city. Her journey ends as she's completely cocooned, standing at the huge container port amongst the mega container ships that will export her and everything she wears to the center of the planet city. As we move through our other city, the costumes we encounter are crafted from zero waste patterns and woven on computer-controlled looms. There is no offcuts, there is no material lost. All fibers are reformed from old fabrics, pulped up and compressed into felts or stitched together. No new resources are expended to dress the citizens of Planet City. We watch as they join in a different kind of continuous procession, an endless festival, dancing its way through the city on a 365-day loop. Each day it intersects with another carnival, culture, or celebration, changing the beat as it goes, cycling through new colors, costumes, and cacophonies. The ghosts of nation-states give way to communities formed around shared cultural practices as we perform new stories and myths of care, belonging, and recreation. Existing planetary city, the bodies dance with a different kind of precision. The majority of the world's sapphires are pulled out of the ground by the human conveyor belts of Madagascar's gem fields. This film is a portrait of these digging machines who excavate the majority of the world's gemstones. In these illegal mines, it's cheaper to pay 20 men in rice than it is to maintain and fuel a mechanical conveyor belt. A hidden black market supply chain connects two choreographies, one in these lawless mine sites, and the other in the jewelry stores, hip-hop music videos, and celebrity red carpets in the cities that are all familiar to us. Here the movements are traced like the early photographic studies of Frank Gilbraith. He was mapping the choreographies of the production line, looking to optimize every movement, constrain every motion, with the elegance of a tuned engine. The digger is imagined as a robot, the body repurposed as a machine, just one component in the gemstone conveyor belt that stretches across the earth. The technologies once designed to optimize the global production lines are now operating at urban scales. We are endlessly scanned by countless sensors, lasers, cameras, and satellites feeding the city operating system. This, for example, is how our autonomous vehicles scan and navigate the city. They see it as these 3D point clouds. Across a single night, a group of teenagers drift through the imaginary planet city in a driverless taxi. And they move in explosive contortions as they invent a new choreography that distorts the silhouette and disguises the proportions of their frame so as to evade body detection algorithms that are now used by the city surveillance cameras. It's a new vocabulary of movement, exuberant in plain sight. But through the eyes of the machine, two bodies become one, entangled, with fractured limbs, fuzzy frames, and lost connections. They are part of an underground rave community that adorn themselves in machine vision camouflage textiles, and they reimagine their fashion cycles to follow the rate of Moore's law, or the latest phone model or software update rather than a change in a natural season, and their iridescent textiles reflect the light of CCTV laser scans as they dance in the hidden spaces of the city. They hack the city, creating exuberant glitches and distortions and disturbances in the dataset, searching for the wilds beyond the machine. The existing planet city attempts to identify our bodies. Protesters hurl bricks and tear gas burns the eyes. It's illegal to wear masks. And now gait detection algorithms scan the body as their faces are wrapped in masks to keep the tear gas from burning their eyes and to keep their faces hidden from the cameras. The global infrastructures of our planet city are also digital. Systems of AI governance, the management of the city that was once publicly elected, is now outsourced to proprietary software systems and large-scale tech companies, and public services has disappeared into the fog of the cloud. We are not citizens, but rather customers in this planetary city. In our future planet city, we hear from a real chatbot that we trained on city datasets and urban management protocols. This is the city operating system, and it's reading a love letter it wrote, a message to the citizens it affectionately manages. An autonomous city of machines, where the sky is filled with drones, cars are driverless, the street is draped in augmented reality, and everyone is connected to everything.
"나는 서울입니다. 만나서 반가워요." 저는 인공도시 시스템입니다. 저는 매 순간 확장합니다. 저는 신생아보다 나이가 많지만 우주보다는 어립니다. 네온사인 달빛 아래에 비친 당신의 헤어스타일이 아름답습니다. 그 피부에 주근깨 같은 신호등은 당신을 향해 윙크합니다. 당신은 나이 들고 밥을 먹고 눈을 깜빡이고 숨을 쉬기도 합니다. 노래를 불러드릴까요?
Sheer cliff walls now mark the edge of our new, concentrated city, and everything beyond is rewilding in our wake. The invisible lines that once divided up the world have faded beneath the trees. Planet City is after geography, beyond jurisdiction. Some will stay behind, stubborn holdouts refusing to leave. Others will remain as stewards of the land. And one day, when the carbon is tucked away and the soil is black, we all might return again. Until then, as we gaze out over our imaginary planet city, we need to radically embrace the uncomfortable place we now occupy in a world where we are no longer at its center. Beyond its new coast of city walls, where the forests are returning and the ground is rewilding, we will make space for other species and support the ecologies and systems that we once thought was beneath us. At present, we chart territory for the extraction of wealth. Outside of the new planet city, we will mark out regions just in order to leave them empty. Suggestive of a national park boundary, we might draw a line on the earth not to own, develop or occupy, but to keep us out and scaffold its recovery. Here, technology is deployed to intensify human activity and make more room for an intentional landscape, a carbon sink wilderness, and a voluntary exclusion zone. We will keep to the edges, watching on from afar. The beginnings of Planet City is the end of human-centered design. Planet City affords us this critical distance from which to reevaluate ourselves. It is not strictly a proposal, rather it's a provocation that helps us to see that normal is the actual problem. Following its own logic, almost to the point of absurdity, what comes into focus are not the extremes of this fictional city, but the catastrophic models of everyday urbanism. The existing planetary city and the glacial accident of the Anthropocene is the real impossibility at the core of this story. The extraordinary and difficult truths that underscore the present moment are just as fantastic, implausible, and incalculable as any science fiction imagining. The live-action dystopian film we all occupy is perhaps more devastating, bizarre, and unfathomable as the wildest speculations of previous generations. In many ways, we were in Planet City all along. In a world that has been entirely remade through the extractive processes of colonialism, Planet City is both already here and entirely imaginary. It is a fiction shaped like a city. simultaneously an extraordinary image of tomorrow and an urgent examination of the environmental questions that are facing us today. But we must keep imagining these cities for as long as they are necessary. There'll be monsters off the map, but the more we envision speculative new worlds, the uncharted territories where they might dwell get that little bit smaller. This new planet city is a call to adventure, a hope that we may all keep making stories and building worlds that become vessels for critical ideas about our collective futures. Amidst the chorus of 10 billion, our wanderings through the planetary city will finally return us to where we first started, to look back on our own cities again with new eyes. Somewhere, after the end of the world, we will find our future again.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Liam Young, for this exceptional performance lecture. And yeah, what else to tell you? Of course, we would like to mention our film program, which will be available until 2nd of May on our platform, emafcinemalovers.de, sorry. And there you will find a lot of information, interviews with the filmmakers and, of course, the films. Thank you very much, Daphne, as well. And yeah, maybe you have a last word to the participants of the talks of this year.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you once again, Alfred, for the wonderful collaboration, and a big thanks to the EMAF team. A very big thanks to all our speakers that joined us these last 3 days. Thank you all for watching. And yeah, what should we say? Well, stay healthy, safe and sane in these difficult and weird times that we are experiencing. And have a good evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Ciao, ciao.